I'm a world Olympic weightlifting champion. There are 3.5 billion people on the face of the earth. They call me the strongest man in the world because I can lift over 6,000 pounds at one time, more than anyone else has ever lifted. Now these things I say not boasting. I'm saying these things to make a point. Yes, it's a thrilling thing to be an Olympic champion called the strongest man in the world, but the greatest thrill in my life is being a Christian, having the opportunity to stand up, witness for Jesus Christ. Now, friends, don't misinterpret what I'm saying. The greatest thing, yes, because God giving his son is the greatest thing that ever happened in the universe. So, if he lives in my heart, why, it's the greatest thing in my life. And I want to shout about it.
Paul Anderson was born on October 17, 1932 in Toccoa, Georgia. His father worked for the Tennessee Valley Authority, and his mother, Ethel, was a housewife. He grew up living a very normal childhood in spite of the fact that he and his family frequently moved. He was a typical boy. He loved his dogs and he loved to take them hunting. While in the first grade, Paul became ill. This illness would impact him for the rest of his life. From childhood on, nothing came easily for him. Because Paul was incapacitated at the age of 5 with Bright's disease, that is, a chronic inflammation of the kidneys that ultimately claimed his life in 1994, he learned the true secret of running the race of life. He refused to be hindered by physical obstacles or challenges. When told by his doctors that he would not be able to play outside, with his parents' encouragement, he eventually was able to do so. Initially, his mother followed the doctor's orders, but Paul did not get better. After a while, she changed his diet in order to, as she saw it, feed him properly. Protein became a big part of Paul's new diet, and he began to grow stronger and stronger as a result. Even at a young age, Paul's strength began to grow, and young people began calling him Atlas. By the time he reached high school, Paul had built himself into a strong athlete. It was not long until the members of his high school football team wanted him in on their league. He was a big and strong young man, and it made him stand out among his peers. While playing high school football, Paul began focusing on weightlifting. He and his teammates would gather at his house and lift weights. At that time, weightlifting was considered an unhealthy part of an athlete's lifestyle, unlike it is today. In fact, Paul's coach did not like that his boys were lifting weights. He feared the practice would make them muscle-bound and negatively impact their performance on the field. He believed it would slow them down. This attitude, as absurd as it seems today, was widely accepted at that time. In fact, young men like Paul who lifted weights had to do so often in secret, and more than likely, they didn't have the proper weights to lift. At 19 years of age, Paul was already becoming a big boy. At 5'9", his neck was 21.5 inches thick, his arms were 20 inches, his thighs 33 inches, and his calves 19 inches. By pushing his body to the limit, supported by his mother's high-protein diet, he eventually earned a football scholarship to Furman University in Greenville, South Carolina. It was there he began taking weightlifting to the next level. Even so, he was still an outsider. He did things his own way. Rather than buying legitimate barbells and weights, Paul preferred visiting the junkyard with his father and making his own weights out of scrap metal. As Paul began to experiment more with weightlifting, he discovered to his and everyone else's amazement that he was able to lift more weight than anyone else. Because he could break world records, he decided to leave college and pursue weightlifting. However, due to his size and sheer strength, proper training equipment was difficult to find. Nonetheless, Paul's creativity and ingenuity accelerated into high gear, and he built his own training gym out of automobile axles, drive shafts, buckets, barrels, and 2x4s that he had salvaged from the junkyards. Paul would take metal barrels and fill them with concrete. He once filled a safe with cinder blocks and strapped himself above it as it rested in a hole. He then would lift the safe. Perhaps the most famous of all of Paul's homemade weights were built by his father from heavy-duty equipment wheels, which had been used in a rock quarry. These wheels, often referred to as the wagon wheels, are still on display at the Paul Anderson Youth Home today. Even with his remarkable strength, Paul was still not broadly recognized among weightlifters. That all changed when he won the Nationals for the following year in June of 1955. He was 22 years old. That began a new chapter in Paul's life, one that would ultimately see him honored with the title of the world's strongest man. Winning the Nationals in 55 allowed Paul to travel to Moscow, where he captured the world's attention during an amateur weightlifting contest by lifting more weight on his first lift than any of his famous Russian competitors. After astounding the Russians, Paul was called Chudoporodny, a wonder of nature. He had also become known as the Dixie Derrick. At this meet, he broke two world records. From Russia, he traveled to many Middle Eastern countries and served as a goodwill ambassador for the United States. In the fall of that same year, Paul added to his fame by winning first place in the World Championship in Munich, Germany, where he surpassed two more world records. By this time, Paul had astounded sports enthusiasts throughout the world with his strength. As part of the U.S. weightlifting team for the 1956 Olympics in Melbourne, Australia, everyone, including himself, thought the gold medal was in the bag. No other weightlifter was within 100 pounds of his total lifts. When the team arrived in Melbourne, Australia, prior to the competition, Paul became unusually feverish and unsteady. In fact, his temperature reached 104 degrees. Both doctors and officials reported that he would not be able to lift. Paul said, "I tried praying, but my heart had grown cold from years of ignoring God." With steel-like determination, he doctored himself with aspirin to lower his temperature and tried to mask the seriousness of his condition. 12 days before the event, he had lost 30 pounds, and it was visibly obvious to everyone that he was very sick. However, Paul had not come to the Olympics to lose, or to even come in second. He had come to win. After two failed lifts, Paul rested before his final attempt and was abruptly awakened by the announcement, "Paul, in order for you to win, you will have to lift an Olympic record of 414 pounds to make up for your first two lifts." Paul Anderson showed his desire to win by asking for the 414 pounds to be placed on the bar. His first two tries completely failed, but the bar never got past his chin. Before facing his final attempt, he merely had 3 minutes to get himself together. Walking a long, dark corridor, he recalled, "I felt as if God was reminding me of everything He had done for me. He had made me who and what I was. My successes were because He extended my life when, as a child, Bright's disease threatened my very existence. In spite of His innumerable blessings, my response, up until that time, was to ignore Him." Chalking up for the final lift, the arena went silent. Pulling the weight to his chest in the cleaning motion, he knew immediately that he could not put it overhead. Now desperate, Paul admitted to God, You have given me everything, but up until now, I have given you nothing. He prayed, I am not trying to make a deal, God, but from here on out, I'm making a real commitment. I will to you my life. Bending his knees to push the weight, the bar stayed on his chest for what seemed an eternity. He gave the final push and drove the bar overhead. It stayed. The crowd went wild and an Olympic champion was born. Paul summed up his win this way. I had lifted far more in the past and would lift even more in the future. The poundage was not important. Even the gold medal was not the real prize. A far greater miracle had occurred. What I really won was not an Olympic championship measured by the poundage of man, but the strength of God's Holy Spirit. I had finally learned that His strength would not be diluted by the diseases of my vulnerable flesh. Today, Paul is the last American super heavyweight to come away with the gold. That year, Paul's stature had grown to match his Olympic status. His neck had increased to a thickness of 24 inches, his biceps to 24 and a half inches, his chest was 58 inches, and his thighs were 36 inches, roughly the same width as the waist of an average man. Paul was listed in the Guinness Book of World Records, as well as Famous First Facts, for lifting an incredible 6,270 pounds, the greatest weight ever raised by a human being. This feat was accomplished on June 12, 1957, in Toccoa, Georgia. While many believed Paul could have won more Olympic victories, he relinquished his amateur status so that he and his wife, Glenda, whom he had married in 1959, could establish the Paul Anderson Youth Home in Vidalia, Georgia. The Paul Anderson Youth Home is a Christian home for troubled young men between the ages of 16 and 21 years of age, the majority of whom otherwise would be incarcerated in juvenile or adult correctional facilities. This ministry has directly served over 1,200 young men as well as their families since its inception in 1961. Becoming a professional athlete allowed Paul to provide funds for the Paul Anderson Youth Home through lifting exhibitions and speaking engagements. Until 1983, when Paul experienced renal failure due to his childhood bout with Bright's disease, he tackled as many as 500 engagements annually. He spoke to churches, civic clubs, high schools, colleges, businesses, industries, and military bases. He almost single-handedly raised the majority of the Paul Anderson Youth Home's operating budget. His messages focused on Jesus Christ, family values, patriotism, and the free enterprise system. This gentle giant credited his Olympic victory with other successes to Jesus. From the podium, he used his influence as a Christian athlete to set spiritual goals and instill moral standards in those who heard him. The booming voice of the world's strongest man mesmerized as well as inspired his audiences. In addition, he authored 3 books, numerous newspapers and magazine articles, poems, weightlifting courses, and a nationally syndicated newspaper column. In 1977, Paul received the coveted Golden Plate Award, which was given to him by the American Academy of Achievement to those who have made great accomplishments. Paul's hometown of Toccoa, Georgia, declared May 25, 1983, Paul Anderson Day, and erected a 7-foot, 16-ton granite marker at his birthplace. Paul served on the board of directors and advisory board of the Fellowship of Christian Athletes. He was given the Branch Rickey Award, the highest honor presented to laymen by the FCA. On February 14, 1992, because he was hospitalized, their daughter, Paula, accepted his award when he was inducted into the FCA's Hall of Champions. His plaque of recognition is on display at the FCA National Headquarters in Kansas City, Missouri. To Paul Anderson, the greatest challenge was not lifting weights, but lifting the spirits of teenagers, which he did as only a champion could do. Paul faced a personal struggle as his health continued to decline due to failing kidneys that had succumbed to extreme damage from his childhood Bright's disease. In June of 1983, Paul's sister, Dorothy Johnson, gave him a kidney. God allowed this gift to miraculously extend his life for 11 years. During those years, he exemplified suffering without complaint. Many that were closely associated with him during those last years commented that he not only taught them how to live, but also how to die. On the foggy summer morning of August 15, 1994, Paul went home to be with his Heavenly Father. One of the finest accolades Paul Anderson ever received was given by a member of the news media who had observed his work at the Paul Anderson Youth Home for several days. He is the world's strongest man, and he also lifts weights. Paul's legacy all began with a lift on November 25, 1956. It was an athletic feat that astounded the world. For Paul, however, that lift was a divine appointment, a supernatural encounter with God that changed his life and emblazoned his heart with a vision to reach others for Christ. Paul's legacy was more than weightlifting titles and a museum full of trophies. Rather, his true legacy is found in the lives of troubled young men 16 to 21 years of age who had been court-ordered and the majority of whom were miraculously transformed during their time at the Paul Anderson Youth Home. The PAYH is often called a miracle home by such notables as the late Chick-fil-A founder S. Truett Cathy, as well as Orlando Magic president Pat Williams. President Ronald Reagan said this about Paul Anderson: "You opened a door not for yourself, but for young people who were homeless and misguided. Thousands of people have, thanks to you, been provided a Christian home-like environment. Its unique rehabilitation program is based on biblical principles, combined with the kind of work ethic that built a weakling into an Olympic champion. Over 90% of the young men who have graduated from the program have gone on to live productive lives and have not returned to incarceration. The Paul Anderson Youth Home is a miracle home because it was birthed from a miracle." Paul Anderson's lift paved the way for the Paul Anderson Youth Home, the greatest legacy of the world's strongest man. His was a difficult, challenging calling, and yet God prepared him for it as a young child. True legacies are not built on media hype. They are built on tenacious faith, unshakable commitment, and impeccable character that befit Paul Anderson's Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, the one he served.
Behind us, find us faithful. and our children sift through all we've left behind. May the clues that they discover and the memories they uncover become the light that leads them to the road we each must follow.
Jesus Christ, the guidance of the Holy Spirit, you're not making it at all.